with you. Today's episode is on accept and allow versus control and force. And those, I don't know if they sound interesting or not, but in the amount of time that we've been able to work with clients and in our personal experience, what we have found is when you come from allowing and accepting, you come from a space of love and a space of power. When we come from control and force, we come from hate and resistance. And I want to just give you a couple ideas here. When we come up against challenges, we'll use an example of my twin brother's suicide. We come up against these challenges, and when we try to control and force how we feel, we come from hate and resistance, and we struggle really hard. When we come from allow and accept, could I change it? No. But I could choose how I wanted to feel about it. I wanted to allow and accept what had happened, and now I could come from a space of, I want to remember him for the good. I want to remember him for what I was able to share with him and have those good memories. So those are just a couple of things that I want to get your mind thinking and really get into this, because we're going to be talking a lot. Bill and I are both going to be sharing stories and different pieces of information in this episode. Another one that I want to bring up is sometimes we don't have any choice in someone else's choices. Other people make their own choices, dang it. And even our kids make choices, and maybe we don't agree with it. When we try to control and force, what we come up against is resistance, dislike, and anger, frustration. When we can allow and accept that they have their own choice and that they have their opportunity to be big and choose their choices, however that may look, we come from a completely different space and we allow them to have some choice.
Well, and we feel like that this is an important thing for both of us to share together, because with Kris, with the mentoring and training that she does, and with myself, with the healing and releasing emotional blockages and stuff, it's this same principle that can make the difference between success and failure on both ends. For the people that you're mentoring, for the people that I'm working with on healing sessions, is about accepting and allowing, but still working towards changing without going into that, I have to control it, I have to force this thing. You know, force it and control it. And when you do that, like Kris says, it turns into a negative feeling. It goes to hate and resistance. And then you got this big energy blockage here. No matter whether you're trying to change something about yourself, a health issue, a relationship, whatever it is. So there's a very fine line to walk, and that's what we want to talk to about today.
Awesome. Before we get too far into this, we want to encourage you to get your gift. Go to our website. It's allthingspossible.biz. That's www.allthingspossible.biz, right here on the screen.
Da-da-da-da.
And
sorry.
And get your free traits. We teach 7 traits, and it's a way to change your life and almost immediately have results if you will align yourself with those 7 traits in your life. So let's get started with this. And first I want, Bill, I want you to kind of talk about how you got into this. How did we start to recognize this?
This principle I first got real familiar with about 15 years ago when I really started working with energy and getting into energy healing on a deeper level, really realizing that this was a passion that I have in life and a gift and a talent to work with energy. And if I can introduce you to a principle, it's called cloud busting. And if you're interested in this, just research on the internet. Cloud busting, there's other things that are a little bit different, but you'll find what we're talking about here. But here's the principle. You can take and stare at a cloud up in the sky, and just pick a small cloud and focus your intention on that, and just think, you know, I would like for that cloud to just kind of melt away and disappear. And when you do that, if you just have those kind feelings of, you know, I would like that to happen, you will watch it just melt away and disappear. And I am totally amazed, like with my kids and showing them.
And me, if it sounds crazy, I thought it did too. And I was like, okay, you go bust a cloud for me. I have to see this.
And she had to see it several times before she decided.
Because I would get there and I would go from control and force and I'd be like, dang it, go away. Didn't work.
And she'd say, oh, that was just a coincidence. But she did. We did it enough that she could see, no, there is something to that. And I love this principle. Not that I don't want everybody to go out and make clouds disappear. We don't need a drought. But it's something that you can see. Clouds are very subtle energy. It's just moisture in the air. Okay? And but yet you can look at a cloud and you can see definite and immediate results what you're doing. But what a couple of things. You just have to want it. You have to set your intention. I would like this cloud to disappear. If you say it has to disappear. And the first time I tried to show people, oh, watch, I can make a cloud disappear. I'm so cool. Total fail every single time. I remember one day, I really wanted my dad to be impressed with me as to how cool I was. You know, I mean, son, he knew I was cool, but I wanted to think I was really cool. So he's sitting on the porch one day when I was visiting him. I says, Dad, I can make that cloud disappear. He says, no, you can't. Yeah, I can, Dad. Really, watch me. Dad was right.
Well, and I think he wanted you to keep to mutton busting.
Yeah, mutton busting. Plow busting. Dad was a farmer.
Plow busting. Okay.
Okay. But I couldn't make it happen because I wanted it too bad. I was just like, it was very, very important to me to show Dad how, you know, I wanted him to be impressed that I was learning things like this. And I couldn't make it happen. It's just like, yeah, you're right, I can't do it. Although I knew I could, but in that moment I couldn't because I wanted it too bad. So if you look at that cloud and you think angry thoughts or anything negative thoughts, I don't like you, you're an ugly cloud, you need to go away. They won't go away. Try it for yourself. But when you can think of it with love and just say, you know, it's okay if you don't, but I would really like it if you would just like melt away and disappear. It will work. So that was my first introduction to this principle of working with energy. How much control we have over our lives. And this is, I wanted to teach my children this. It's like, be careful what you think and what you say, or be conscious, because it has so much power on the world around you. And working with the clouds, they could immediately see their results as to when they were not getting results.
Right. What we focus on is what we get. So when we're focused in the negative and we're focused on that control and forcing things, we stay in resistance. We stay stuck.
You've heard us say that love is the greatest power in the universe. And this is really when you can love it in gentle feelings, it's amazing the power that you have. But when you come from a negative side and this has to happen and it must happen and I'm going to control, it locks it right down. And really that's a principle that applies to, I think, anything that we're trying to change in our lives.
Absolutely.
There's a fine line to walk, and we'll get into where that fine line is. Another thing, I just did a video a few weeks ago on tapping, on emotional freedom technique. Okay, if you remember, if you haven't seen it, go back and watch it. It's
I
powerful
think it's
healing.
The last one, actually.
Is it? Okay. Very powerful healing modality. But you begin that with a setup, rubbing some particular spots on your body to access your energy systems within your body. But the setup statement is, let's look at this, it says, so for example, if I was trying to control my fear of deep water, I would say, even though I'm afraid to be in deep water, I deeply and completely accept myself. Even though I'm afraid to be in deep water, I deeply and completely love myself. You repeat that three times. You go through the tapping procedure. You do a reset on your hands. Watch the video. It's amazing. But then when you get done, at the very end of it, you go back in again and you say these love and acceptance. And what that is, that's a matter of allowing. Because when we are in what we resist, persist. And when we're in resistance to something, energy is meant to flow. It's fluid. It's meant to just move along. And when we put in resistance and negative feelings and hate, it almost just locks up and impacts. You heard of stuffing your emotions? They do. They get compacted in little teeny stuck balls of energy within us. And all these things. And anything that we're trying to work with, that energy just, it locks up and it sticks. And anytime you got stuck energy, it's a bad, bad thing. Okay? You don't want that to happen. So that's why EFT works. And yet, with focused intention, you know what? Even though I have this phobia of water, even though I have this headache, I'm still okay. It's a way of accepting and allowing, and many times just that, and then of course with EFT you're tapping, at the same time you're sending that energy into all of your different meridians. With that accepting, allowing, and with love, it'll just go away, okay? And that principle works in so many areas with the mentoring that she does, with the healing that I do.
Well, definitely. Even as I mentor different clients, I mentor a lot of women, but I do some men as well. And when I do mentor them and we start talking about what's going on in their life and what's happening, whether it's the relationship with their spouse, whether it's the relationship with their children, we get talking about the different things that they're struggling with, and we can almost always take it back to control and force. When we try to control and force things to happen, we end up in resistance. As a mentor, when I work with clients, a lot of times when we start working into the issues, possibly it's a child that's wayward or doing their own thing or making their own choices. Even as young children can try to do things that you don't want them to do, the more that we try to force, the more we try to control them, the more resistance that we get. When you try to keep your child quiet in a surrounding where most people are quiet, the more you try to force that, the sooner they're in resistance, are going to make noise. So a lot of times when I'm working with clients one-on-one, I find that whenever they try to control or force the situation, whether it's a relationship with a spouse, and maybe the spouse doesn't talk as much, I wonder how I would know something about that, or you get into a situation where it's, you know, a child. It can be a grown child that's making different decisions than you raised them, or different than what you would choose. And when we get into that, we do totally bring up that resistance, that hate mentality, that dislike. And not that a child or a spouse is going to hate you, but it does bring up that dislike and the resistance that comes with it.
It's natural for us to want to, especially when it comes to children, you know, when they're younger, you will clean up your room or whatever. You don't have playtime, and we could really force them. And as they get older, yes, we need to do that to teach them, but as they get older, we need to allow them to start making choices. But it's hard to, it's our natural go-to emotion or go-to thing to just want to force them, to tell them what to do and expect that it be done, to control situations.
I'm the mom, I'm the boss. One of the things, we had one of our children, I'm not telling you which one, but one of our children, we used to laugh and say, "You are not the mom. You do not get to control this. You do not get to force it." And it was interesting because it was part of his personality and part of the way he wanted to be was to control and to force. And I can't say that I've always been in acceptance and allow, because there's been definitely some times, many of you know that we recently had a daughter that traveled out of the country all by herself and without a plan. And for me, that was very difficult because I wanted some control. I wanted to be able to know she was safe and to be able to know that she had the things that she needed and that she wasn't in danger. And a lot of those times in our lives, when we go into that control and force, number one, we create that resistance between each other. But number two, what we focus on is what we get. And so there again, when I focused on the worry and the frustration and the danger, that's what I felt. Was like, oh my gosh, I don't know if she's okay, and it's been days since I've heard from her, and then there was a landslide, and I don't know if she's alive. So when you go into control and force, you're going to feel those panic, frustration, overwhelm, and those feelings that are of a negative spiral, and it doesn't serve you at all. I want to go into a little bit of acceptance and allowance, because when we accept and allow, I want you to know what it is not.
Because there's a very fine line here with it. There's a very fine line of, do we accept and allow it, do we let it go, or do we control it? And again, if you go back to the cloud scenario, there's a very fine line where we are very effective and very powerful and come from a space of love. So this is a real good thing to talk about, what it is, where that fine line lays.
Right. So what acceptance and allowance is not, is giving up or giving in. Meaning that just because you accept and allow a child to have room to make a choice, it doesn't mean that you give up teaching them. It doesn't mean that you give in to where they get their way.
Hey, we're parents. We still know what's best, right? Yeah, we know what's best for our kids. So just because they make something different, we don't just say, oh, I give up. But there's a fine line of influence and persuasion and love. So
right. And we do need to come from a space of love, whether it's good grades or what you have. Maybe you need to come up with some better choices, some better consequences. Maybe they need to earn privileges rather than just always have them. Maybe you need to set better boundaries. Then allowing and acceptance become fairly easy to fit into that rather than control and force. The second thing that I want to talk about is the giving up and giving in. I have fibromyalgia and I don't take medication. I have it pretty severe, and when the weather comes in and it's changing in Utah, we change weather almost every day, and I can be really miserable. And when I focus on that, guess what happens? I'm in pain, I'm miserable, I'm tired, and I have a lot of consequences. When I was diagnosed with fibromyalgia, it wasn't that I was going to give up or give in. I had to choose how to make my life healthier, how to feel better, and how to be able to handle having that. Now, at the same time, if I'm complaining about it all the time, if every post I put up on Facebook is about fibromyalgia and how miserable I am, and how everyone needs to know all the complications I'm having, that is not serving me.
That's when you're into fighting and resisting. And the other end of that spectrum is when you're laying on the bed and just not living life because you hurt. That's giving up and giving in. It's finding that balance in between.
Right. And it can be, there are some days that it's just like, you know what, I get to give myself a couple of hours. But when we give up and we spend all day in bed and we quit our job and we don't have anything to look forward to, then again, we're focused on that negative and we start to spiral, and all we feel is pain and we're miserable and we can't go to work and we can't function. It's when we get out of that and we don't go into that give up and give in. The other thing is ignoring it. A lot of times we get into behaviors where we think, oh, if we just ignore it, it will go away. We, as a family, a few years ago, took in a nephew. And when we got this nephew, he was 15 years old with a police record, kicked out of high school, and he almost had one full credit at the end of his 10th grade year. So basically, no education. And he had not lived at home for a long time. Some of the things that were going on for him was that there wasn't consistency. Everybody was in control and force him to do certain things, but on the other side of it, there was, you know, no balance for him. People had given up on what to do.
It was either force him or just give up and let him have his way. There was no in between.
And what happened with this was when we got him, he was like, he acted many years younger than he was. And we were like, okay, we got to start and really learn about him and what's going on. As the more we got to know about him, the more we found out with his condition, he had Asperger's. And so by not having structure, by not having a little bit of structure and everything in place of how to help him, he had gotten out of control. And by taking it to accept and allow, we were able to make a huge difference in his life. In 18 months, almost 2 years, he was able to catch up on his education, graduate on time. He was an Eagle Scout, finished his scouting. It took a ton of patience and a ton of work on our part, but it took a ton on his part too. He decided to accept his situation.
Absolutely.
And allow us to help him. He was given choices in every area. If you want to go to the sand dunes, then you'll stay at school all week. If you want to go play, then you'll do this. You can choose. You can choose to be at school and stay there, or you can choose to come home, but you will go stay somewhere for the weekend and not go play with us. There were some pretty harsh We had to have black and white. He was 15, and he needed to learn quickly how to handle that. And he did very well. We love him dearly. Loved him as our own child.
He's doing really good now.
But it was a situation where, number one, he had a condition that nobody wanted to pay attention to. In fact, he was actually diagnosed by medical practitioners, and it was shoved under a rug and said, well, I don't think so, so we're not going to even... It was ignored. And that was the condition. He would have had help sooner. So be careful not to give up or give in to certain situations, whether it's health-wise, whether it's a difficult child. Sometimes we get difficult teenagers and we're like, they're teenagers and they're going to be like this and we're going to be miserable, so I'm going to go to control and force. The more we control and force, the more they act out. The more that they put their walls up and they push back. And then we don't have the love and the power. When you can come from love, you have a lot more power. We've had situations with a couple of children. We have four, but we have a couple that have chosen different choices than we would have chosen for them or wanted for them. And in that decision-making time for them, we've had to learn how to come from unconditional love.
Yeah, and absolutely. We have to find that balance. And you know what? That balance is not the same place for every person. You really have to be in tune to the individual and to be in tune with your heart and your intuition, your higher power, to know where that fine line is. Because there's a very fine line where you are working at maximum power, right in there of accepting and allowing, but with love influencing. I think the perfect thing for that is the serenity prayer. God, forgive me if I don't do this just right, but it's...
Did you not go to AA?
I haven't been for a while, let's put it that way. God, give me the strength to change the things that are within my power. Give me the serenity to accept the things that I cannot change. And give me the wisdom to know the difference. Okay, and that's where I think if we can use that as a good guideline, what things can I change? Give me the power to do that. The things that I can't change, accept them. And then wisdom to know the difference. But you know what? There's things that we say we cannot change in life. The death of someone is something that you cannot change. So do we give up and give in? Oh, they died. Life is bad. We still have control and power and choice. We can choose what our experience of their death is. Do we choose to focus on the tragedy that they're no longer gone, that they're no longer here, on the injustice of life? Perhaps we can get angry at our higher power, because if he was a loving God, he wouldn't have taken them away from us. And we can get stuck, and this is all stuck energy because it comes from low emotions of anger, resentment, judgment. But yet we can accept and allow. Again, the wisdom. Is this something that I can control? Right now I cannot change the fact that this person is not in my life right now. What I can control is how I feel about that. Do I choose to respect and to honor their memory and what they stood for in life and choose to focus on the good things and moving forward and helping other people that are also in grief about this situation, for example, to move forward, to see the good things? And that's where finding the balance is. We always have influence on any situation. We may not be able to control everything about it, but we weren't meant to. Okay, but we can always control how we feel about it. With our kids, I think you were going to share a little bit about some of the choices that they've made and some options that we had as to where on this scale to control and cause resentment and come from a force to where there's feelings of maybe not go as far as hate, but very strong negative feelings to accepting love. Where do you find that balance in between? Do you want to share about that?
Well, one of the things that a few years ago, our oldest son had his second bout with cancer. And that's one of the first things that I want to kind of to bring up is that it's not in his control. Like getting all upset that we have to go through brain tumor surgery over and over and over. I mean, those feelings come in, but we've got to control that. We've got to be the one that chooses the choices that we want. Make a decision that you don't have to be completely possessed by what's going on with you. And that sounds funny, but it's true. when he was diagnosed with cancer, we went to that total, what is in our ability to change? What could we do? You know, could we change that he had cancer? No. Could we change that it grew back? No. So we had to come to that acceptance and allow for the doctors to do what we had to do. We even did a bout of everything natural healing that we could possibly do, made a decision, tried to do something a different way, and we weren't having the success we needed. And so we had to, again, accept the situation and go ahead and have surgery the third time. There's a lot of things that happen like this. We have a child, we have a son that is gay. And that was not in our belief system. That wasn't something that we...
I never suggested it to him.
Well, it wasn't something we ever thought we would have to, I guess, deal with is the words that I'm looking for. But we had a son that totally chose a different path. And there's several ways you can handle that. We chose to accept and allow. It was his choice. He was over 18. And we gave him all the information that we could because what we wanted for him was happiness. And in the end, guess what? He's happy. He's got happiness. And he's making the choices that he feels are in his best interest. But as long as we tried to control and force his choices, it didn't work. And maybe you don't have a child that's choosing a different lifestyle. Maybe your child is choosing alcohol. Maybe your child is choosing, you know, that... the different classes in school, doesn't want to go into college, doesn't want to have the education that you think he should have. Maybe you want him to be a doctor and he's not. We need to have the opportunity to accept and allow them to do things the way they're going to do them and let them make their choices. Yes, we need to be parents. Yes, we need to guide, we need to direct, we need to lead, but we don't need to force. We don't need to try to control. Let's go to a child, to an infant. If an infant is crying, fussy, upset, the more you try to quiet the baby, stop the baby from crying, the worse it gets.
When you force that child, just, you are going to be quiet because I said so, because I'm the adult. Hey, I really believe that's where a lot of shaken baby syndrome comes from. It's people get so frustrated, you have to be quiet. And it just builds to where it's a battle of wills and the child doesn't stop crying and they end up hurting the child that they love more than life, and yet they hurt it because they're trying to force that. And they get so stuck in this force cycle.
Well, and they go into resistance. So both parties are in resistance, so the baby's upset and frustrated and tired, the parent's frustrated, tired, the babysitter, whatever that is, and then we go into a cycle that is completely in the negative, and we're on the downward part of the spiral. We're in overwhelm, frustration, anger, and we feel out of control. And yet when we can accept that this baby has colic, these are the things that we need to do about it, these are the steps we can take, we need to allow for those things to happen. And when we do that, we can be more centered with ourselves, we come from a space of love, and then we have more power.
Well, and back to the thing with Blake, I've seen a lot of families, when you get in stuck in that cycle of, I'm going to control this, I've seen several families who have told their children, if you're going to live like that, you are not welcome in this house. You're not welcome at our family parties. Don't come around and embarrass us. And there's no positive outcome there. I'm actually not aware of anyone who's ever said, oh my gosh, if you're going to not allow me to come to the Thanksgiving party, then yeah, sure, I'll change everything about my life. Yeah, absolutely. Just don't make me miss the turkey. It doesn't happen. It just creates... It spirals down, and it creates more discontent, and it turns into hatred, and those very negative feelings when you try to force and control. So we can still invite, and this is a very extreme situation. I hope that your challenges that you may be facing are a little bit more minor than that.
But we want minor.
Yeah. We'll
please
choose easy.
Pick me. I want minor.
I'll choose easy anytime. But yet, it's a matter of, if you choose to accept and allow, then you still have a good family relationship. You still have love. And you allow that person to have their experience in life.
Very good. Thanks for joining us today. Our time is up, and we have been thrilled to have you with us. Again, if you have not got your 7 traits, It's a video series that you get to have our seven traits, and it's free to you. Go to our website right here on the screen, www.allthingspossible.biz. Again, www.allthingspossible.biz. Thanks for being here, and we hope that you can take in your acceptance and allow versus control and force. Have a great week, and we'll see you next time here on All Things Possible TV. Bye-bye.
See ya.